Hey, what's up guys? Fabio here once again. I'm going to welcome you back. Today I'm going to be doing a different video. I'm going to be talking about Monster-Mania 32, which I attended yesterday. Today is actually Saturday, but this video will be uploaded on Sunday, along with my review of Mad Max Fury Road. I'll be uploading two videos in one day just to kind of get things going a little bit quicker here. And like I said, today is Saturday. Usually when I go to conventions, it is on Saturday. But I don't think I had my Fridays off last year when I first started. I may have gotten those. I'm not sure. But I do have every Friday off, which is awesome. I love having Fridays off. That's just one of the best things about my job. I love having Fridays off. And I usually go to these horror shows with my cousin, but he had to work today, so we just decided to go on Friday. And that actually worked out because Fridays usually aren't too busy. They can get a little busy depending on who's at the show and stuff like that. But it was pretty good. Wasn't too crowded. You could move around and stuff like that. Of course, there's lines. There's always going to be lines at these shows. And again, it depends on who's there. But it was great. It was great to go on Friday. And like I said, it was less people. It was a little bit easier to maneuver and stuff. And I had a blast. I try to go to Monster Mania every year. I went once, and then there was a couple years where I think three years, that I didn't go. No, 2 years. 2012, 2013, I didn't go. Last year I went, so there was only 2 years that I missed. Which sucks because, like, Adam West was there 1 year, a bunch of people were there. And for those that don't know, Monster Mania is a East Coast horror convention. They do two in Cherry Hill, New Jersey, which I've never been to those ones. I'd like to go, maybe next year, depending on my situation and everything. Maybe I'll go up to that one as well as Hunt Valley. And I go to the one in Hunt Valley, Maryland, because it's literally right down the road, about 45 minutes, very close. Near Baltimore, where I grew up, so I do like to go to the hometown shows. I don't go to Baltimore Comic Con because it's honestly nothing special. I've never gone to that one, but I've heard it's nothing really special. But maybe 1 year I'll go, I don't know. But yeah, it was good to go. Like I said, there was a couple years. I went last year. I don't know why I'm saying this, but I missed a couple years because of different things that were going on in my life. But I did go yesterday, and I had a blast. I always have a blast when I go to these shows because I get to hang out with people that have the same interest in me as me. I get to see a lot of really cool stuff. I did pick up some stuff, of course, in addition to autographs. And it's just a good time. You know, there's just always a good time at Monster Mania. The three that I've been to were great. The staff is great. The staff is really cool to work with. They help you out all the time. And they always have a good guest list. This year, unfortunately, Roddy Piper had passed away. He was supposed to be at this show. I wanted to meet him again because it had been a couple years since I met him. And he was just a great guy. Unfortunately, he did pass away. Keith David was supposed to be there from The Thing, They Live. He did the voice of Goliath on Gargoyles. He's been in a lot of things. But he could not make it because of filming, unfortunately. And Denise Crosby from Star Trek The Next Generation was supposed to be there. I think she came today, but to be honest, I wasn't really interested in meeting her. I mean, she was only in the first season of The Next Generation, and then she died. So, I mean, it's not like she was Riker or somebody important, but, oh well. I know she was also in Pet Sematary. But there was a bunch of good people there this year. Matthew Lillard from Scooby-Doo and Scream, SLC Punk, Wing Commander, he was there. Miko Hughes from Pet Sematary, Kindergarten Cop, a lot of other things. Terry Kaiser from Weekend at Bernie's, Friday the 13th, 7. Tom Atkins was there again. Got to talk to him again. George Romero, Nick Castle, who was the original Michael Myers, Don Shanks, who was Michael Myers in 5, also Charles Cypers was there, Roger Jackson, who did the voice of Ghostface, Nikolai Volkoff is always there, Tony Moran, who played Michael Myers at the end of the first one when they took the mask off, I think his name's Will Sandin. He played the little kid, Michael Myers, from the first movie. He was there. A couple other people from Pet Sematary. Dale Midkiff. Another person I didn't recognize. There was two people from The Thing. There was Tom Waits, who was also in The Warriors. He was there, but I didn't get a chance to meet him. Another guy from The Thing. I think the guy that played Fuchs or something. I can't remember. It's been a while since I've seen that movie. Dee Wallace was there. Meg Foster from They Live and Masters of the Universe. Alan Howarth, who did the music from Halloween, was there. I think that's pretty much it. I think I got all the big names there. But I met a couple of people. I did meet Matthew Lillard. He was the longest. He was obviously one of the bigger names there. We waited about an hour and a half for him, but he was totally worth it. He was very, very nice. Very cool guy. He talked to me and my cousin. He asked, you know, what your names are. He's like, so what would you guys be in? Like, if you guys were in a movie or something. I said, we'd be cops. I just kind of said that. And I said, and you have to be our commander. And he's like, no, I can't do that. And he was just very, very nice, very cool. We only got a picture with him because he wanted 40 for an autograph and then 20 for a picture. And honestly, like, I get that it's Matthew Lillard, but I wasn't willing to pay 60 bucks. I got a picture. That's all I need. Me and my cousin got a picture. And of course, at the end of the video, I will put all the pictures in a slideshow like I did the last time. But he was very cool. You know, I asked him about some things. Because I know, like, now he is the voice of Shaggy ever since Casey Kasem passed away. And I know they just did the Scooby-Doo and Kiss movie. I asked him about Kiss. He's like, oh, they were really weird. And then he started laughing. He's like, no, they were pretty cool. I'm like, oh, that's cool. And I asked about, I said Wing Commander. I said, oh, I like that movie. And I do. I don't think Wing Commander is that bad. He's like, oh, that. He's like, I had a great time doing that movie. It was a lot of fun. I said, sweet. And I asked about Summer Catch X. No, asked. He's like, really? You like that movie? I said, yeah, I really liked it. He's like, that's cool, man. I appreciate that. I said, yeah, you got to work with Fred Ward. He's like, yeah, Fred Ward is the man. I'm like, well, duh, he was in Tremors. So, doesn't get any better than that, but he thought that was really cool. I asked him if he was still friends with Freddie Prinze Jr. He said, unfortunately, no. I said, I'm sorry to hear that. He's like, yeah. He's like, well, as long as you and your cousin stick together, you'll be fine. I said, yeah, we're not going anywhere. And he's like, yeah, we were talking about Kiss and Scooby-Doo. And he's like, yeah, he's like, there's a new show is coming on, and I'll show you guys a clip. And he pulled it up, and he showed us a little clip. I said, why is Shaggy so skinny? He's like, I don't know. He's like, I don't know why I showed you guys that, but I did. I'm like, that's cool, man. And we took the picture, and he was like, so do you guys play Dungeons & Dragons? Because I know he's a big Dungeons & Dragons guy. I said, yeah, a little bit, and I have. I played a few times. I don't know much about it, but I like Dungeons & Dragons. The times that I played it, I enjoyed. I had fun. He's like, yeah, that's cool, man. And I said, yeah, did you ever see the cartoon? He's like, wait, there's a cartoon? I was like, yeah, it came on in the 80s. I said, you can find it on DVD. He's like, oh, cool, I might have to do that. And, you know, we shook hands. I said, you know, thank you, and, you know, thank you for all you've done. He's like, no problem, man, and nicest guy. I mean, he was the nicest guy. Very, very cool. Then we went over to see Miko Hughes because he was literally right next to Matthew Lillard. Like I said, Miko Hughes was from Pet Sematary. He was the little kid. He was also in Kindergarten Cop. He said, boys have a penis, girls have a vagina. He was in New Nightmare. I forgot to ask about Life with Louie, which was a Fox Kids show that I used to watch. He with Louie Anderson. He did the voice of the little brother. And he was also in Full House for a while. He was in Spawn. He's been in a bunch of things. Mercury Rising with Bruce Willis. Walked up and said hi. I said, how you doing? He's like, oh, I'm good. Can't complain and everything. He had a picture of him and Arnold from Kindergarten Cop, like a publicity photo. I said, so was Arnold cheating on his wife back then? And he started laughing. I said, I don't know about that. But he said Arnold was really cool to work with. He said he bought all the kids Walkmans. I was like, wow, that is really cool to hear. He's like, yeah, Arnold was like the nicest guy. I said, sweet. And I asked about New Nightmare. He's like, yeah, you know, New Nightmare was fun to do. He said Full House was cool. It was cool to be on that. I asked about Bruce Willis. He's like, yeah, Bruce Willis was kind of a dick. I said, oh, this isn't news. He's like, yeah, when he was filming, he was okay. Like, when he worked with the other actors, he was fine, but he didn't get along with the director, which isn't a surprise. He's like, yeah, he's just really into being a movie star. And I was like, yeah, it kind of sounds like it. But, yeah, he's like, yeah, he was kind of a dick, you know, but oh well. I said, but I really enjoyed that movie, Mercury Rising. I told him that. I said, and I really liked you in that movie. I said, that was a challenging role. He's like, yeah, thanks, man. I appreciate that. He's like, yeah, that took a lot of time to prepare for, and, you know, it's not easy. It was not easy to do that. I said, that's great, though. He's like, I appreciate that. And I talked about Spawn. I said, I really like Spawn. He's like, thanks. He's like, I do have a picture, but I don't have it with me because not a lot of people ask for it. And he's like, yeah, and I actually just ran into Michael Jai White for the first time since we filmed the movie. He said he was out at a convention in California just hanging out. Like, he wasn't appearing there. Like, he said one of his friends was one of the Power Rangers. He didn't say which one. He said it was one of the Yellow Rangers. So I think it's Serena Vincent from Lost Galaxy, because I know she's been in other things besides Power Rangers. And he's like, yeah, and she's really hot. I started laughing. And he's like, yeah, Michael was there, and I walked up, and he said, you probably don't remember me, but I was in Spawn with you. He was like, oh, yeah, Miko, and they took pictures and stuff. I said, oh, that's really cool. He's like, yeah, Michael is, like, the nicest guy, very, very cool. I said, yeah, you know, I'm a martial artist like he is. He's like, oh, that's awesome, man. But Miko was very nice, very down to earth. He's not much older than me. I think he's only, like, 6 years older than me, so that's not too bad. But very nice dude, very cool, very nice to meet him. Then we went and saw Terry Kaiser from Weekend at Bernie's. Very, very nice man. You know, walked up. He said hello, shook his hand and everything. And I said, so what's it like to be Bernie? He's like, well, the checks have never bounced, so I'm good. And I started laughing. I said, yeah, that is a good thing. And I talked about Friday the 13th. He's like, yeah, that was fun. That was a lot of fun to do. Very cool movie. And I said, yeah, Kane Hodder was here last year. We got to meet him. He's like, oh, yeah, Kane, great guy. Love him. I said, yeah, very cool guy. Took a picture with him, and I asked about Chuck Norris because he did, he did a few movies with Chuck Norris. He was in Eye for an Eye, and he was in Forest Warrior, and then he was also on a couple episodes of Walker. He said, Chuck is the sweetest guy on earth. He is just a sweetheart. I said, yeah, that's what I heard. And he's like, and Walker was fun. He's like, Walker, we had a lot of fun doing those episodes. And I said, yeah, the one, because there was one, he played a character a couple times. He played, like, this con artist, but he was, like, a likable con artist. Like, you like the guy. And there's one episode where he went undercover, because he looked like this bomber. And he's like, yeah, that episode was a lot of fun. I really liked doing that. And, yeah, very nice guy, Terry Kaiser, very nice, very cool. I got a picture of Friday the 13th, because, you know, I love Weekend at Bernie's, great film, but Friday the 13th, you know, Weekend at Bernie's, he was dead. He didn't do anything, you know. But Friday the 13th, he was a slime ball. You wanted to see him get killed. Sorry about that, folks. For some reason, the camera just decided to shut off. I don't know what that was all about. Again, I'm having a lot of issues with this camera lately. Working to get a new one. And I was talking about Alan Howarth. And like I said, we had talked about Halloween 3, the soundtrack to that. And he said, basically, John Carpenter just called them up. He said, hey, we're doing Halloween 3. It's going to be different. There's going to be no Michael Myers. But I want you to do the music. He said, you know, we had fun doing 2. We did a lot of different stuff. And I want to keep doing that. I want to do completely different stuff. And that's cool. And we talked about The Thing. Because, like I said, he helped out on that. And he said, yeah, Ennio Morricone was John Carpenter's hero. You know, that was his guy. And he called him. And he played the soundtrack to Escape from New York. Eno loved it. Did the thing. You know, they did it one time. And then they went back and they changed some things. But he said it was great. You know, it was great to work with him. And, you know, he's a legend. You know, he did the good, the bad, and the ugly. And didn't ask him about some other stuff like Big Trouble in Little China, Halloween 6. I just forgot, you know. But Alan Howarth, to me, is like, I'm a musician. I consider myself a musician. Not very good. But that's, to me, that's a big name, because he did, you know, if he didn't do the music, Halloween would have just been another movie that nobody cared about. If it wasn't for the music, the music is a big part in that movie. I absolutely believe that. But I got a Halloween 3 soundtrack signed by him, got my picture taken. Very cool man, very nice. He had some vinyls. He had Halloween 1, 2, 3 on vinyl, and I think They Live and maybe Big Trouble in Little China on vinyl, but those he wanted like a lot of money. $20 for the CD to get signed, and you know, that's fine. But very cool, very nice man. We just talked about the music. Very nice guy. Like I said, I forgot to grab that. I knew I forgot something. So when I'm done, I'll go grab it and add it into the video, and then I'll do the slideshow. Then we walked around a little bit, saw the merchandise, basic stuff, some cool stuff. I got a couple things. Didn't get much, but got a couple things. And then autographs. Actually, shit, I forgot to show my autographs. There's Miko Hughes. I got a behind-the-scenes picture of New Nightmare. I said, you know, since Wes Craven's gone, I like that one the most. And it just says, to Fabio, never sleep again, Miko Hughes. And then he had a couple pictures. He said his mom found another picture of him in Wes Craven. He said he was going to get that one blown up and everything. I said, cool. Then he had a couple pictures of him and Robert Englund behind the scenes. Pictures from Pet Sematary, and then one picture from Kindergarten Cop, like I said. And then here's Terry Kaiser. It says, to Fabio, hi, Terry Kaiser, and then he signed Dr. Cruz at the bottom. So there you go. Yeah, I like Friday the 13th more than Weekend at Bernie's, so there you go. And then, like I said, Alan Howarth, I'll grab the CD later. And the reason why I grabbed that, because I think Halloween 3 is my favorite, the score is my favorite. I had it downloaded, and then it disappeared from my computer, so that's one of the reasons why I picked it up again. But classic soundtrack, can't disagree with what people say about the soundtrack. So like I said, then we walked around a little bit, then we went up and saw George Romero. Now, we waited, I think, about 45 minutes for him, but again, it's George Romero. He's an icon. He's a legend. You're going to wait for him, you know, just like everybody else. But the problem with George Romero was that you had to buy something from him. You couldn't just get a picture. And he had a ton of stuff. He had DVDs, Blu-rays. He had a ton of pictures. He had beanies. He had little stuffed bears that looked like him. But it was like the DVD was like $50. I'm like, you know, I already have most of these movies on DVD, and I don't really want to do that. So the cheapest thing was a tie, which I bought, and it's not just an ordinary tie, which is pretty cool. It actually has his glasses on it, which I, you know, that's cool. You know, I wear ties sometimes when I dress up and stuff. So I think that was pretty cool to get. You know, $20 for a tie and to get a picture taken with him, can't complain. So I got it, you know, walked up. Got this. He was going to sign it, but they're like, no, that's, you can't sign it. And they're like, he was kind of like bummed out about that. And like I said, I don't, you know, he had a lot of stuff. He was charging a lot, but I don't think it was him. I think his agent kind of does that. And that does happen with a lot of celebrities. Their agent's like, well, we can make a lot of money. And but I don't see George Romero saying, yeah, we got to charge for everything. You know, I don't see him doing that. But sat down, took a picture with him, shook his hand, and I said, I want to thank you for all the great stories that you've told us over the years, and I want to thank you for putting Pittsburgh on the map. He's like, well, thank you. He's like, are you from Pittsburgh? I said, no, I'm not. I said, but I do have family up there, so I know the area and stuff. And I said, they're from Monroeville, so the mall and everything. And he laughed. He's like, well, thank you, and you're welcome. And that was it, you know, George Romero. But yeah, unfortunately didn't get an autograph, but I can get those on eBay. But I think that tie is pretty cool, you know, different. It's pretty cool. But hey, at least I got to meet him. That's not working. Hold on. There we go. Now I hung it back on the bed the right way. At least I got to meet him and get an autograph. Then I walked over, talked to Tom Atkins. I already have his autograph, so I just got a picture with him, which he didn't charge for at all. Excuse me. And I talked to him. I asked him about Lethal Weapon. And he told this hilarious story. He said, yeah, Lethal Weapon was fun. He said, I really liked working with Richard Donner, great director. He said that on Fridays, they wouldn't film on Fridays. He said they would go to the studio and they would watch all the dailies. Which I've heard that before about Richard Donner, like on the Goonies and other things, other DVDs and stuff. And he was like, yeah, you know, they would have food and beer and cigars, and it was just like a party. Like, we would have this big party on Fridays, and we would just sit down, and, you know, we would watch the scenes and everything. He's like, really cool. And he said, and he liked working with Gary Busey. He said that they shared a dressing room. And he's like, yeah, I really like getting killed in the, like, when Gary Busey was in the helicopter. He's like, I really enjoyed that part when I got shot through the helicopter. That was a lot of fun. And he's like, yeah, he's like, the day that we filmed that, me and Gary were getting dressed, you know, we were chatting and stuff, and he went to go make a phone call to Richard Donner. And, of course, you know, you want to listen in, so he's like, so I heard him, and basically the conversation was this. Well, I'm not fucking dying my hair, I'm not playing this fucking albino, I'm not fucking dying at the end of the movie, I'm not fucking dying my hair, and just going off, and every other word Tom Atkins was fuck. That's what he said. He just fuck, 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 fuck. And then he got all quiet and he's like, yes, okay, I understand. Yes, yes, okay, bye. And of course, when he came back, Tom was like, so what was that all about? He's like, well, he told me basically if I didn't want to do the movie, that's fine. He'll find someone else. And I said, I'll do it. So there you go. That's funny. You know, you don't hear those kind of stories all the time. But that's pretty funny. You know, he's like, yeah, but Lethal Weapon was fun. I like doing the movie. And then I asked about Striking Distance, which he did with Bruce Willis. He just had a small role in that. He's like, yeah, Striking Distance was cool. He's like, I liked working with the director, Rowdy Harrington, who also did Roadhouse. He's like, he was a good guy. He's like, but Bruce Willis was just a jagoff. And I said, yeah, I've heard that. He's like, yeah, he's like what Miko Hughes said. He's like, when we were filming with the actors, he was cool. Not a problem with the actors. He's like, but the director, he just didn't get along with the director. And he was just really into the whole movie star thing. Like Miko Hughes said, he was just really into the whole thing that he was Bruce Willis. You know, he was the guy. And I said, yeah, you know, that's unfortunate to hear. He's like, but he's like, with me, he was cool. I had no issues with him, but with everybody else, he was, you know, the director, when he was doing other stuff, he was kind of a jagoff. Not jack-off, jag-off. That's Pittsburgh talk. And then I asked about, because he did an episode of Walker, Texas Ranger. I asked about Chuck Norris. He's like, well, Chuck Norris kicked me in the face and I fell down the stairs. Other than that, he's a good guy. So he was just joking around. But Tom Atkins, very, very nice, very cool. I walked up. I actually had my, here it is. I'll just show it. I actually got this the last time that I met him, because he sells them, which is shirts from Night of the Creeps that say, Thrill Me. So I got that, and he's like, hey, I like your shirt. I'm like, yeah, I got it from you last time. He's like, that's cool. I like that. And I said, he's like, what's your name? I said, my name's Fabio. He's like, hey, Fabio. And he looked at my cousin, and he was like, and your name's Jimmy-O. And we started laughing. And then when we left, you know, we took the picture. I said, you know, thank you again, sir. I said, good to see you again. He's like, yeah, good to see you. You and Jimmy-O. And he's like, what's your real name? Colin. He's like, Colin. I like that. So, yeah, Tom Atkins is, like, the nicest guy. Seriously, the nicest guy. And then we went over and saw Don Shanks, who, like I said, played Michael Myers in Halloween 5. Very nice, very cool guy. Walked up, got, I'm just organizing the autographs here. Got, actually, let me, I'm going to finish Don Shanks and then back up a little bit. Don Shanks, very cool, walked up. Introduced myself. I said, so Halloween 5? I said, I like the movie. I said, I've always thought it was a good movie. I like it. He's like, yeah, I like it too. And I asked him, I said, you know, I've heard all these rumors over the years that you guys filmed this whole other ending to the movie. He's like, no. He's like, that is not true. He's like, we filmed, the only ending we filmed is the one that you see where the man in black comes in and gets me out of prison. I said, okay. And he's like, but we filmed a whole nother beginning, which I know he talked about on the Blu-ray. He's like, yeah, we filmed this whole thing where we got this young comedian, like this young punk rock comedian from Salt Lake City where they filmed the movie. I forget what the guy's name was, he told me. And he played like this voodoo witch doctor. And after I get blown up and everything, he takes me in. There's like this stone with the thorn symbol, like he put it on me and he was like gonna curse me, and it, like, he put it on this thing and it spun around, and then on Halloween it was supposed to stop, And then I get up and I kill him and I like break his neck and I like stab him and then I break his back and then throw him on this big table with the thorn symbol. It was this big elaborate beginning, he said. And he didn't say why they cut it out. And then he's like, I don't really know why we cut it out. And then we went and refilmed it with the older guy, made it more simple. And he said, unfortunately, the younger guy passed away. I said, I'm sorry to hear that. He's like, yeah. And I asked, I said, so I heard that you killed the SWAT team and they cut that out. He's like, yeah, you know, what happened was the movie got an X rating and we had to cut, you know, that stuff out. He's like, yeah, like one guy, I broke his neck. You see the glass in the guy's face. I stabbed a guy in the eye with an M16. I said, and they cut all that out. He's like, yeah, you know, the MPAA with the violence and stuff. I said, but, you know, the thing is, it's not real, and they know it's not real. He's like, you know, Friday the 13th, the guy got a flare in his mouth. I said, but it's all special effects. He's like, oh, well. And then I asked about Revenge of the Ninja, because he was in that as one of the hitmen, and he also did stunts, which I didn't know. He's like, yeah, I actually doubled for Sho Kasugi, and I doubled for the bad guy, the guy with the mask. I said, oh, really? I did not know that. He's like, yep, I doubled for those guys. And I said, and you also played one of the hitmen. He's like, yep, I did all that. And then he was also in Three Ninjas Knuckle Up. And he's like, yeah, that was fun. He's like, I was only supposed to be there for 2 weeks, but I ended up staying the whole shoot. And he said the director was very interesting. He said he was a Korean gentleman. And basically, he was like the biggest director in Korea. He's like, he was the Spielberg of Korea. And what happened was, like, the government wanted him to make all these, like, propaganda films. And he said no. So they, like, kidnapped his wife. And he can only see his wife, like, once a year. So he agreed to make these movies. And they were filming, like, this boat chase in, like, the harbors of Korea. And him and his wife got in the boat and escaped Korea. And got here to America and everything. And I thought, wow, that's, you know, an interesting story. He's like, yeah, he was a very interesting man. And he said, but the problem with the movie was we had Chinese, Japanese, and Korean crew. The actors and the stuntmen were the only people that spoke English. He said, so they would go through the translators, and then they'd yell action, and nobody really knew what to do. He's like, so yeah, it was a little bit of a difficult movie to film, but he said it was a lot of fun. So I was like, cool. So took a picture with him, got an autograph, which I'll show in a second. I said, I want to thank you. You know, I really enjoy your work, and I said, you and Mr. Castle, Nick Castle, are the only two guys I have not met as Michael Myers. I said, once I meet you guys, I met all of them. I said, and you guys are my favorite. He's like, well, thank you. And he's like, well, Mr. Castle's the best one because he's the original. I said, ah, that's not true. He's like, no, he's the best. So that's very cool, very humble guy. And I got a nice black and white photo. And he didn't personalize it. It just says Don Shanks. And then he put Michael Myers. So really nice picture there. I love black and white. I think that's the best. Really like that picture. That's from the ending. But yeah, Halloween 5, I know people shit on the film. I mean, it's not perfect. It's definitely not a perfect movie, but I've always liked it. You know, I grew up on that one. So they're fun movies to me. Backing up a second, I forgot to talk about this guy, but Sean Clark was there from Horror's Hallowed Grounds. And I don't know if he was there last year, I saw him walking around. I was like, oh, yeah, Sean Clark, cool. And when we were standing in line for George Romero, he was talking to a couple of the other guys there. I guess he was the head of all that. I don't know. And I walked up while we were waiting. I said, excuse me, Mr. Clark. I said, I'd like to get a picture with you if you don't mind. He's like, yeah, sure. I said, he was wearing a Kiss shirt. And I said, I love your shirt. He's like, thanks, man. So we took a picture. And he's like, hey, do you want an autograph? I said, yeah, sure. He asked what my name was. I said, Fabio. And he's like, okay. So he signed the autograph. He had this one, which is from Halloween, and then he had one from Nightmare on Elm Street. I got the Halloween one because I'm a bigger Halloween fan than Nightmare on Elm Street. And he gave it to me. I said, how much? He's like, oh, no, it's free. I said, really? He's like, yeah, I don't charge for autographs. I said, oh, great. Very nice guy. And he also gave me a sticker of Horror's Hallowed Grounds. And I love those. I think those are really interesting. Like the Halloween 5 one, Don Shanks was in. I know the guy that played Grady from Nightmare on Elm Street 2 popped up in one of them. And I think this is in front of the house. I don't know. I think this is in front of the Michael Myers house. So it just says, to Fabio, happy Halloween, Sean Clark. So very nice guy, very cool guy. Like I said, I love all your videos. I love all your stuff. He's like, thanks, man. Very cool guy. Very nice. And, yeah, so, hey, not bad for free. So there you go. I think that's it for autographs. Yeah. Oh, no, there's one more. And then we went over, after Don Shanks, we went over and saw Nick Castle, who was the original Michael Myers. And really quick, like, with him, I, you know, it was getting towards the end of the night. Of course, everybody's getting tired. But I got a picture, and I sat down, took a photo with him. I said, hi, how you doing? My name's Fabio. And I asked him, I said, I know everybody asks you about Halloween. I said, but what was Walter Matthau like? Because he directed not only The Last Starfighter, but Dennis the Menace, Major Payne. And he said, Walter was great. He's like, but he was a gambler. He's like, every weekend when we weren't filming, he would be off at the track spending money. And then he would come in and be like, well, you know, gotta work, gotta make more money. So he's like, yeah, he was always gambling. And he's like, and we shot Dennis the Menace during football season. So there you go. I was like, oh, that's very cool, though. He's like, but no, he's like, all kidding aside, Walter was a joy. He was so good to work with. And then I said, yeah, Major Payne, I like that movie. He's like, oh, thank you. He's like, that was a lot of fun, too, doing that. And that he had a picture of Last Starfighter above him. And I said, but that movie is the end-all, be-all. He's like, I really appreciate that. I'm like, yeah, Last Starfighter rules. But I got a, you know, the classic shot of him standing over the stairs, and it says, to Fabio, Nick Castle. Very cool, very nice guy. Like I said, very quick-like with him. Because at that point, it was like, the show started at 5 and ended at 10. That was like 8:30. So we were like, you know, we were trying to finish up. You know, of course, everybody's tired and stuff. But, no, very cool, very nice guy. And then we went back downstairs because my cousin wanted to meet Roger Jackson because in addition to Ghostface from Scream, he did the voice of Mojo Jojo on the Powderpuff Girls. And they talked back and forth in the voice, which was really cool. They are doing a new Powderpuff Girls, and he said he's going to be in that. And, you know, he talked on his Ghostface, because I said, yeah, you know, this Ghostface. And he's like, well, thank you. And very cool. Very nice guy. I didn't get an autograph or a picture, because at that point I was running low on money. I wanted to pick up some items. So, you know, I said I was out of money. He's like, that's fine. He's like, but you have a camera. I'll take that. I'm like, what do you mean? Like, he was messing with me. Very cool dude. Roger Jackson was very nice. And my cousin was wearing a Doctor Who shirt, so he started doing the voice of the Daleks. He was like, exterminate. Very cool. Very nice guy. Maybe next time I see him at a show, I'll get an autograph and stuff. But very cool. Very nice guy. After that, we walked around a little bit. I bought some stuff. I got, actually, a laser disc, which is cool. So I got two DVDs, a laser disc, and I got four posters. I'll do the laser disc first. Talked about this movie in my last update, how I was supposed to get it, and it never showed up. But finally got New Nightmare on Laserdisc, so I now have all the Nightmare on Elm Streets on Laserdisc. I paid $20 for this, but I figured, you know what, I get it now, I don't have to pay shipping, I don't have to wait. Got it. Good. Done deal. You know. So finally got New Nightmare on Laserdisc. Like I said, this does have TV spots, which did not make it to the DVD. But, oh well, you know what, it would have been cool to get Miko Hughes to sign this, but, yeah, oh well, maybe next time, but, yep, New Nightmare, great. I really like this movie, I really enjoyed it, it's one of my favorite Nightmare on Elm Streets, very underrated. And then I got Tron on DVD, and this is the old two-disc, which says just Tron, not Tron, the original classic. I think that's stupid how they do that, but this is the one that has all the features, which is why I got it. This was $5, you know. I got this from the $5 DVD guy. Last time I bought something from him, it was a data disc, and I had to watch it on my computer, so I actually ended up getting another copy of it. It was the Phantasm 2 work print. I ended up buying the one from Germany that had the work print and the behind the scenes, all the other stuff that I bought from this guy. So, yeah, you know, it's probably just an honest mistake, but I just bought a regular DVD instead of a bootleg from him. But, yep, finally got a hold of Tron. Been wanting to get this forever. Great movie. And then I got The Best of She-Ra, Princess of Power. Yes, I wanted to get this because It has the Secret of the Sword, which is the She-Ra and He-Man movie where they team up. And then it also has the five best episodes. But it also has two art cards. So if you want to get all the art cards, you have to get this set as well. It also has the music video, I Have the Power, audio commentary on Secret of the Sword, and a brand new documentary about the series. So, yep, this was $5. I got this from a different vendor. But I was like, oh, wow, She-Ra. And they're like, yeah, we bought it for our daughter, and she didn't like it. I'm like, what? How could you not like She-Ra? I said, that's okay, though. But, yeah, I bought it. So now I have the Best of She-Ra. And I have Season 1, Volume 1, which you'll see in the next DVD update. So I just need Season 1, Volume 2, and Season 2, and I'll have all of She-Ra. Because they never did a... That would have been cool when they did the He-Man, the 2002 He-Man. That would have been really cool if they did a remake. I don't know if you call it a remake, but another series of She-Ra. That would have been cool. So there's that. Then I got some posters. These are Rock Band posters. Not the game, like actual Rock Bands. Now, of course, these are not originals, but... You know, reprints are just as good. So, I got three Kiss ones, and I also got Van Halen. It was, you had to buy two, and then you got two for free. So, very cool guy. He had not just music, he had movies, he had everything. But I got music, because that's what I like. And I was on the lookout for Kiss stuff. The only stuff they had, a guy had the Psycho Circus toys, but I think... No, I don't have those. I used to have them, and I got rid of them. I gave them to... a friend of mine's dad, because he's a big Kiss fan, but I wasn't going to buy those. I mean, I'll buy them again, but I didn't want to buy them yesterday. And then a guy had Kiss Meets the Phantom of the Park on VHS. I have a DVD-R of it, because the DVD is really hard to find. But the guy wanted $20 for it. I'm like, I'll get it off eBay cheaper. And then, of course, all the bootleg vendors had Kiss Meets the Phantom of the Park, but I already have that. So I found some posters. But first I got Van Halen. This is from their last club show at the Whiskey A Go-Go before they went on their first world tour. So, there you go. Really cool poster. Like I said, these aren't originals, but originals are going to cost you an arm and a leg. Reprints are just as good. So, there's that one. And then I got a shot, a nice black and white shot of Kiss. And it's just a, like, backstage photo. And I really want to get this one autographed because I think this is really nice. Maybe... if I ever meet any of the original Kiss members, I'll get it signed by them. This is a really nice picture. So, there you go. Yeah, I would really love to get this signed. Because I know Peter Criss does some conventions. Ace Frehley does some. So those would be the easiest ones to get. Maybe I'd have to send it away for Gene and Paul to sign. But, you know, that's still really, really cool. Really like that. And it's in black and white. So there you go. And then I got this one, which is just the pictures of the solo album covers that they did in 1978. So you get all four of the faces, which that's pretty cool. And then this one is just simply the artwork for Love Gun, which is a great album. One of my favorite Kiss albums. So there you go. It's got Shock Me. It's got Hooligan. I Stole Your Love. The title track, obviously. Great songs. So that's basically it for this part of the video. Like I said, I will grab my Halloween 3 CD to show you guys. And then I will do the slideshow of all the pictures at the end. But like I said, this will be uploaded Sunday. So you'll see this video and Mad Max Fury Road at the same time. So I hope that you guys enjoyed this video. Had a great time at Monster Mania. I might be going to another convention in December, depending on the weather and stuff like that. That one's in Pittsburgh because Ric Flair is going to be there. Adrian Paul from Highlander. I've always wanted to meet him, so that's like the big thing for me. Ric Flair would be cool to meet too, but Highlander is the thing I'm more into. So I might go to that one. We'll see. Maybe do a video there. I didn't take any video of Monster Mania. I just didn't feel like it, to be honest with you. So you won't be seeing any video. You'll just see pictures. But I hope that you guys enjoyed this video. And stay tuned because I'll probably upload Mad Max Fury Road before this. And then I'll do the reviews for Jurassic Park. So you'll see the Jurassic Park reviews next after this one. So anyway, thank you guys for watching. And I'll see you next time. Take care and bye-bye. So here is the Halloween 3 soundtrack. It says to Fabio Alan Howarth. And then he actually also signed, if it wants to open,
the CD itself. And this is the complete soundtrack, because I know they released, like, back in the day, like, the regular soundtrack, which is all the songs on this side, and then they did, like, the remastered version. So that is the complete soundtrack. Only 1,000, so at least I got one of them. But, yeah, Halloween 3 rules. Too bad the vinyls were expensive, because vinyls look really nice autographed and stuff. But, yep, that is it. So now the slideshow.